Welcome here, everybody. Good to see everybody here. See some familiar faces. You guys want to join us in worship? Come on to the front. And yeah, let's have a good time worshiping.
great is our God.
Please be seated. Well, it's pretty full here this morning. I want to start by welcoming anybody who's visiting us this morning. You're very, very welcome here. And we're going to take a quick look at the bulletin. I probably should have taken a better, closer look ahead of time, but let's take a quick look. Congratulations to Kelvin and Norma on the birth of their baby boy, Wyatt Nolan. Also, VBS is set for July 7th to 11th. And we're excited, but here are a few ways that you can help to make the week a success. They need some help leading worship each evening. They need some group leaders and some group helpers. You can become a committee member, and there's some information there for how you can sign up for that. Finally, we are doing a thing called 24 Hours of Prayer next weekend, Friday, or this coming up weekend, Friday at 5 p.m. till Saturday at 5 p.m. And we're asking that everybody who loves to get together and to pray, not even get together, just to pray because you're going to be doing it on your own for an hour, that we want to see 24 one-hour slots signed up for. We are actually only have about four slots left that haven't been signed up for. You can see it at the coffee bar. So please sign up for those. And then maybe we can find a way to sign people up for second, you know, if more people want to sign up. Let's get two or three rooms of people praying. Also, there are some prayer cards back there, and if there's something in your life that you would like some prayer for, just fill out one of those prayer cards, and we'll make sure they're available to people to be praying for you over a 24-hour time of prayer, and we'd also encourage you to do that, 24 prayer, and even try fasting, which is giving up food for 24 hours to really focus on a time of prayer. So, that's going on. I would just challenge and encourage you guys to sign up for that. And then I'm super pumped. Next weekend, next Sunday, we have Baptism Sunday again. Man, we've had a lot of these lately, and that is something we're celebrating. And so if you have told God that that you've given your life to Jesus and not been baptized, Bible says that's the first thing you should do. Repent and be baptized. So talk to Lauren. Lauren, wave your hand. He's way at the back. If you don't, you should all know him, but if you don't, if you are interested in taking that step of faith, go talk to Lauren about that today, because we can get you baptized next Sunday. So we are super excited about that. So, tithes and offering. We're going to invite the ushers to come forward for tithes and offering. And if you are a visitor, every now and again I remind us of this. It seems like there's a lot of visitors out there. What we do as a family is we believe that God wants us to do a lot of really amazing things around the world, and so we put our resources together to make that happen. The Bible says that we should give our tithes and our offerings with kind of generosity. We should be generous people, and so we collect those as a family to do the work that God has called our family to do. If you're a visitor, don't feel like you have to put something in there unless you really want to, because this is the family all pitching in to do the work of God around the world, and we've got missions that we support and people we support all over the place, and so that's what this is for. If you're not aware, and like I said, if a visitor, feel free to let that thing go by. God, you are so good. God, I'm just so excited for what you are doing in the lives of people here at our church and around the world. God, I just want to pray that we just continue to be faithful, to be people who are not ingrown, but that are doing everything in our power to see the entire world be blessed and be changed in your name. So God, help us to use this money incredibly faithfully as we faithfully give what we've committed. We just love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. In fact, I'm currently getting ready to get my tickets ready to go to Mozambique, planning my trip to Mozambique coming up, and I'm super excited about what that's going to look like. So I didn't specifically pray towards my message, but you know, maybe I should do that right off the hop again. God, guide my words. You're awesome. Amen. Sometimes it's as simple as that. Hey, God, guide my words. I'm reminded of, I don't know why it reminded me of that now, but when my dad was flying his plane from up north, and so there was no lights out, and it was cloudy, and all the power went out in his plane, and all of a sudden he's flying, but he doesn't know where he's flying, and he sees lights in the distance and realizes they're not lights this way in the distance. He's flying straight at Earth, and all of his equipment's down, and he just says, Jesus, help me. Sometimes we make prayer these extravagant things, and sometimes, and I don't know, maybe it's just somebody need to hear that this morning, sometimes your prayer might simply be, Jesus, help me. You don't have to be a complicated person to say, Jesus, help me. I'm going through something right now. Prayers don't always have to be extravagant. They have to be genuine. To genuinely say, God, help me. Help me today. All right. Well, we are starting a brand new series today. It's a series that I've titled Adopted or What is Church? And we're looking at what church is supposed to be in the Bible. We've built a lot of stuff in our modern day world off of tradition, off of this is how we've done it for the last 1,000 years even. And did you know that you can't always trust tradition? As a matter of fact, we build these entire churches on this idea that this big, somehow extra wise guy with a big beard can yell at you for an hour and you've arrived, you've come to church. And the word pastor, which we're not going to get into today, it's another message. The word pastor is mentioned one time in the whole New Testament. And we build everything upon one individual who just talks to us every week. And that's really not the heart of church. And so today we're going to focus on one part of church about serving one another. And so although my series is called Adopted, today's message is leading in serving. And I'm going to be honest, we're jumping ahead in the series. So I've got this series, and I jumped way ahead right off the start. Because one of the things in God's family is that he calls different people to different roles in the body of Christ. And one of those roles is a title called the deacon, and we'll get into that. And we want to bring on more people into leadership, and so we want to introduce them to you today. And so I wanted to preach on it first so we understood it, rather than wait 6 weeks into the series and then have to wait 6 weeks before we call on people to help us in leadership. And so we're jumping ahead. Next week, we're going to do the first one in the series about being adopted into God's family. Because that's really the core of what Christianity is all about. We sometimes forget that. We sometimes think that Christianity was that only that moment where I said, me and Jesus, I'm like, Jesus, I'm repenting and I want to follow you. And it's always just me and Jesus. And actually in the Bible says that we are adopted into God's family. That initial relationship with Jesus Christ was simply this between you and God. But part of that between you and God was that you became part of a family. And you can read that in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 and 5 as an example. We'll be preaching on that a little bit next week. But in God's family, we're all part of it. And so if you're a Christian, you should be living as part of family, because that's what you've been called into. Now here at Abundant Life, we also really deeply believe that the gifts of the Holy Spirit are still for today. We believe that God still wants to work in the church today. And so if you read through, you can do this on your own, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it's a preview for next week. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it says, we're all given different gifts to help one another. We talked about this last week. God has a purpose and a plan for your life. And God's purpose and God's plan for your life is not just to, as I say all the time, show up every Sunday and listen to me yell at you for an hour. That is not actually God's purpose for your life, okay? God's purpose for your life is greater, and it comes in being part of a body. The Bible says we are the body of Christ. And in 1 Corinthians 12, 26, read that on your own, but it talks about how if one part of the body suffers, the whole body suffers. And so there's this thing in the Bible that says you might be a hand or a foot or an arm or a toe in the body of Christ. And if you say, I'm not interested in being part of the body, it's like you're cutting the hand off and you're putting it over there, and I'm going to be a hand, but a disconnected hand. Do you know what happens if you do that? Nothing good. I was working in Brazil, learning the language, getting ready to go to Mozambique. And I was working in a construction shop, and I went over there, and I got a little bit scared because I went over to one end of the shop to grab something where they had their safety gear. He said, and they did this to me on purpose. He said, hey, Rick, can you go get the safety gear? And I went to grab the safety gear, and it's a bit gross, but there was a finger by the safety goggles. And I'm like, whoa, what's this? And he's like, oh, yeah, one of our guys working here cut off his finger in the table saw. We knew it couldn't be put back on, so we left it there. And so they left... the finger on the shelf so that everybody coming forward would understand that if you weren't careful, you might lose a finger. And here's the wild thing about the finger. The finger to run the skill saw, the finger sitting there was gross, disgusting, and it was dead. It was dead because when it got cut off from the hand, it no longer got what it needed, and it wasn't moving, and it wasn't twitching. It didn't just twitch for, you know, the next 20 years. It was dead. And so the Bible says we're part of a family, and it calls our family a body. And so in that body, God wants us all to be caring for and helping one another. We are a body. And so I'm going to give you a very bold challenge today, and some of you might not like it. Don't stop showing up to church next week, because we're going to unpack it then. If you don't like what I'm saying now, don't refuse to come next week to get the answer to what I'm saying. But I want to make a statement that some people don't always love. And that is this. You can definitely still be a Christian and not go to church. You won't go to hell just because you didn't show up to church. Okay, that's the first thing. And you can come to church every Sunday and not do anything here. You could just do this as you're like, okay, I got to show up every Sunday. And you will still, salvation is not based on your works, okay? It's not based on your works. But you cannot be a healthy, mature, obedient Christian if you are not in some way connected to the body of Christ. Because if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, there's an expectation that you are part of the family. You're part of the body. And the Bible says that we shouldn't cut ourselves off from the body. Because when you cut yourself off from the body, not only are you hurting yourself, you are hurting the body. If you were to cut off my hand right now, my hand, not only would my hand wither and become not so pleasant, I also would have a lot harder time doing the things that I want to do. It would be a lot harder for me to build a house. It'd be a lot harder for me to drive a motorbike or play hockey. It'd be a lot harder because I would be incomplete. If you are sitting here today, I need you to hear something. We are incomplete without you. You know those little romantic movies? You complete me. That's right. In the body of Christ, you complete us. We can't do it without you. You are needed in the body of Christ, because in the body of Christ, we are a body, we are a family. I better keep moving, or I'm going to preach next week's message today. And so what does it mean to be in the body of Christ? Well, one of the key traits of family is that we love and care for one another. In fact, that is one of the most important parts in a family. And I realize as I read through the Bible, Jesus was insanely intentional about driving home this important fact, this truth, and that is that we are called to love each other so much that we care for and we serve one another. And serving is more than just volunteering. When the Bible talks about serving, it's a serving that is out of the overflow of something that you've committed to in your heart. You see, there's a lot of people who read the Bible and they're like, this is my rule book and I better follow every rule to make Jesus happy. But what makes Jesus really happy, what makes God's joy complete, is if you genuinely care for one another. The acts of service and volunteerism and the acts of helping one another are built on an idea that we love and we love deeply. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 8 speaks a little bit about what this ought to look like. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete. I'm going to stop there. When you read the Bible, words are important. Obviously, you're reading. Words are important. And words that are used a whole bunch of times, extra important. Clearly, there's a point being driven home if there's a lot of words. And the word that it uses here is any. Any. What does that word any mean? Right off the start, what does the word any mean? It means even a little tiny bit. If my vehicle's not running, I'm like, oh my, you know, somebody says, is there any oil in there? There what, like, is it dry? Or is there even a drop of oil in there, right, Kev? If you got a car that you, boom, 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 you know what I'm talking about? What does the mechanic say? Kev, is there any oil? He's not asking if it's full. He's saying, is there even a little bit? Did you check if there was a drop of oil in there that your motor needs? You see, any is important because Jesus is wanting us to hear something here. Therefore, if you have any, even a little bit of encouragement from being united with Christ, if being a Christian gives you even a little bit of encouragement, if you get any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interest of others. In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Jesus didn't need you. I'm going to say, you're not going to like that either. Jesus didn't need you. He wanted you. He loved you. You were built and designed for a purpose. And he was in heaven where all things were perfection. And he chose to humble himself, take the abuse and the beating and the battering to be in relationship with you. And we talked about this last week. Even before he went to the cross, he said, I must do this so that I can go and send my spirit to be with you, because he loves us and he wants relationship. He did not stay where he could for people he did not need. He chose to leave perfection to be with people who would kill him because he was a servant and he loves us. And love produces this idea that we got to care for one another. Look out for the interests of one another. That is what makes God's joy complete. That we look like Jesus in the love we have for one another. Jesus was constantly looking out for the interests of others and seeking to help those in need in so many ways. He fed the hungry. He healed the sick. He taught for hours and hours until people were so hungry that he fed them. He fed the 5,000. He died on the cross. He was beaten, bruised, and tortured in order to serve the torturer. That torturer might one day say, this was my Savior, and God could enter into relationship with him. Another example that we have of Jesus being a servant was when he washed his disciples' feet. This was something we only see a few times in the New Testament, and always by people of the lowest of status. It was something that would be done by servants or adulterous women washing and drying his feet with her hair. It wasn't something done in honor. It was something done in humiliation as a way to humble oneself. And Jesus himself, in order to set the standard of the heart he wanted in his people, he chose to wash their feet. And we're going to read that story right now, and I think the context is important so you can don't get hung up on a word or two. In the context of the Israelite people, the Jewish people, they had over 600 rules. And these rules, they had to live them out in order to be, they called it clean. So if you touched the wrong thing, you were considered unclean. You couldn't go to the temple. There were things you could not do because you were unclean. It was this symbolic idea of righteousness. And so even before they ate, I know we are all supposed to wash our hands, but for them, even more importantly, being physically clean was supposed to be a reflection of spiritual cleanliness. It was a reminder, a symbolic thing that was to last. And so they even had special jars where they would wash their bathe themselves to make sure they were clean before they ate. And so the disciples would have, of course, being Jewish, they would have washed themselves. They would have made themselves clean. They would have come into the home. And yet, of course, they were never completely clean because you were always walking with these crazy feet of ours. And Jesus wanted to teach a lesson. It was just before the Passover festival, which, by the way, if you follow the history here in the Bible, at the Passover festival, what do we get? We get when communion was also introduced, another way for us to remember who Christ was. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with a towel that was wrapped around him. I'm going to keep going, but just let's be real here. If I tried to reenact this for you this morning, you would chase me out the door. If I took off my outer layer, took a towel, and wrapped it around me, I would be considered to be doing something disgraceful in the body of Christ, disgraceful in the house of God. How dare you? And yet Jesus, removing his outer garment, covering his body with this towel, he gets down and he washes his disciples' feet. There we go. Get back to my spot. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Then Lord Simon Peter replied, "Not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "Those who have had a bath need only to wash their feet. Their whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you. For he knew who was going to betray him, and that is why he had said not everyone was clean." When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set for you an example that you should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is the messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them." You see, he was making an incredible point, and he's washing them. They could not be completely clean. They had walked on that floor, and he says, "You must be made clean." And I know we always push to do communion, and we never push to wash the feet, because that seems embarrassing and disgraceful, and like it's a lot easier to just take a little piece of bread and a little drink of juice and be like, okay, I've honored the symbolism of what Christ did for me. And we don't like to do honoring what Christ has told us to do for others. And I'm not saying this is something we have to always do, but I am saying, wow, it really reminds us that this is not about me. In the very nature of what church is, it is not about me. It is about God and serving one another. Maybe even just in the heart. If we could just adopt the heart of that attitude of I will do whatever it takes to lead people closer to Jesus. Jesus going to the cross was an act of serving, or putting into action his love for us by looking out for us at a massive cost. Jesus taught us that greatness in his family was seen not in power or position, but in how we love and we serve and we sacrifice for other people. That is the body of Christ. The call for everybody in God's family is to love so deeply that we are always looking out for one another. We are constantly doing whatever it takes to see God's church, God's family get healthy. I want to read again from Mark chapter 10, 42 to 45. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be a slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus came to serve. If we are called Christians, followers of Christ, Christ-like people, disciples of Christ, apprentices about who Jesus is, we are to be his followers and his example and a mirror image of him, then we too ought to be people who serve. In God's family, we are called to serve. And a true servant is somebody who always is asking, "God, how can you use me to help others? God, here I am. Use me." See, far too often, especially in the world that we live in, is that Christianity has become this thing that we love to own. We own it as, "Look at me, I have arrived." And Jesus said, "Look at them, go help them, help them, help them." It's not about me. It's about making a difference for God, for what he has done for me. We got to get past this individualistic idea and say, "God, use me." where do you want me? In the church, there are also people that God calls to serve by leading. This is an interesting idea. Jesus led, but he was a servant to all. And in the body of Christ, even us who serve, even the pastor, used one time in all of New Testament, even the pastor is only to be here to serve, to make sure that God's plan and vision for the church is lived out. It is not a high office that I rule it over or others rule it over. It is actually designed as people who serve. And so as we are faithful in serving, God may call us to lead. God may call us into different roles in the body of Christ. And so today, every single believer must say, do I love the church enough to do everything I can to serve? But also, I don't want to minimize the fact that I'm supposed to be preaching today on what it means in the different roles in the church. There are actually different roles in the New Testament church. And so if that was the ideal, we should strive to live that out, shouldn't we? And so as we strive to serve God, God may choose to call people into a role of this role in the Bible called being a deacon role. Now the word deacon, actually, if you were to just translate it from its original into English, it means servant. And yet we see in Scripture that there is a specific way that people serve, a specific office of servanthood that they seem to call deacon. Because it is also described as a title given to those who serve in a certain role. So we call the deacon a servant leader. But, you know, these are funny terms. Are you a servant leader? What does that even mean? We use all these Christianese terms. What is a servant leader? Like, what does that mean? And so to give some definition here, when I say God has called those to be servant leaders, what I mean by that is it is a role where a person leads in serving to help the vision or the needs of the church be realized. They work to see the vision and the teaching practiced and proclaimed. They are given authority by church leadership to say, help us, lead with us to see the vision that we believe God has given and the proclamations that we see want to be brought out to the world. Help us in this to practice and proclaim this in a form of leadership. They are given authority under that vision to go out and see it happen. And we see this in the Bible in Acts chapter 6, verses 1 to 7. Early church has started. Here's what it says. In those days when the numbers of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. Basically, there's a little bit of discrimination / racism going on here. People are being fed, and one group's getting more food than the other because there's a lot of bias, even in the church, who would have guessed? And what ends up happening is imperfect people do imperfect things, and people are getting hurt. This isn't working well. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and ministry of the word. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. It's a weird way to end that statement though, isn't it? Hey, there's some hungry people, a little bit of discrimination and racism going on. Let's find 7 people to help the church leaders to live out the vision. And the next statement is basically, and there was great revival. See, great revival didn't happen just in the leadership of those setting the doctrine, discipline, direction. It happened when they found people who loved and cared and had compassion and said, go and show that love, care, and compassion to the rest of the family. And that was reflected and people saw it and they were like, you have to imagine people going, this is a place where people love one another. And the testimony of a church deeply loving one another was something that brought other people in. That's what we need to remember. We need to remember that they were looking for people who would proclaim and who would lead in a way that would fix the brokenness and help the vision become realized. They were looking for people willing to serve. I mean, managing the giving of food to the hungry does not seem like a glamorous job. They weren't looking for people wanting credit and wanting, they were looking for people who wanted to serve. They were looking for people who were willing to be led. It had to have been difficult. Because imagine now your job is to go to the people who were getting favored and say, hey, you've been getting double food allotments. We're going to reduce your food. Woo! You better have some ability to lead to do that. And then humbly going to those who were getting less food and saying, hey, this has been an injustice done. We need you to know that we love you and we're going to treat you fairly. Wow. There's humility, there's leadership, there's servanthood. It's all packaged up and it's all built on this idea of a deep love for others above our own self, to humble ourselves in this way. They were looking for people who were faithful. They were looking for people who had a passion and a deep love for others. Did you know that one of the very first martyrs in all of Scripture was Stephen? The very first martyr was not one of the apostles. It was one of the servants who started off with a deep love and a passion, helping discrimination end, helping to fight this issue going on in the church. But his love did not end there. He eventually began to evangelize, to proclaim the gospel. You see, the disciples set the stage, and he proclaimed what had been taught to him. And in proclaiming that, it was actually a man named Saul who helped with the murder of Stephen for the first martyr. And as we know the story, Saul eventually had a God encounter and became the Apostle Paul, present at the martyr of the first deacon in the church, the first man chosen, because clearly he had an incredible love. They were looking for people who loved, and they were looking for people that other people looked up to. They had the heart of the people in the church. Both Stephen and Philip are known to have been evangelists, and Stephen was the first recorded martyr who was killed. Basically, they were looking for people who were servants of God, who just loved God and did whatever it took. And so we're going to read in 1 Timothy 3, 8 to 10, the qualifications. It's not a big list. We're going to read some of the qualifications. Let's go. In the same way, I'm just going to pause there. If you read that passage on your own, it was just talking about the qualifications of an elder. Now, we'll talk about it later, but elder and pastor are often used together, so it's not just a man, it's this team of leaders that God has called. And so it's talking about what an elder must do. And then it says, in the same way, so just like the moral qualifications of these guys, in the same way, deacons are to be worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. They must be first tested, and then if there's nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. Deacons are people who just loved Jesus and loved other people and were in this state of being transformed more and more into the image of God. And we see this in both men and women. In Romans 16:1, Paul actually says, I present to you Phoebe, who is a servant or a deacon in the church. Treat her. She's coming to you. Treat her as one with that role. He's just like, look, people, these are people who are serving. And they're these leaders who ought to be honored and respected, but also have earned that through this time of testing. In Acts that we read, they should have been known to be people who were full of the Holy Spirit. And so as we as a church said, hey, if they did it in the Bible, we're going to try it doing it here. If that's how they did in the Bible, we're going to embrace the practices of Scripture. And so we here too are looking for people like this. And I want to challenge you. So often in the church, people are like, I want to be an elder. I want to be an elder. And the Bible actually says, and we'll talk about it in our elder message, but that actually an elder includes being a teacher. Not all of you should desire to be teachers, because teachers will be judged far more harshly by God. Imagine, just think about that for a minute. God is actually judging your pastor and your elders a lot more harshly. And so, but yet every single Christian is called to be a servant. If you're going to strive for anything, strive to be excellent in serving. And here at Abundant Life 2, we are looking for men and women who meet the Timothy requirements. We're looking for people. This is simply a person who is living their faith, growing in their faith, who has integrity, and who you see the Holy Spirit working in. By this, I mean somebody who's constantly being renewed, constantly being transformed. They are full of the Holy Spirit, and you see it in the spiritual gifts and the spiritual fruit. And I'm going to preach a message on this down the road, but just for interest's sake, we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, and we talk about the gifts of the Spirit. And just for those who would like a little bit of clarity, the Bible says the fruit of the Spirit. Do we know them? I used to say them all the time. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Okay, so the fruit of the Spirit is when you follow after God with all your heart, when you're attached into God, you're connected with the Father, what happens is the natural production of that is God does something in you. The fruit of the Spirit is what God is doing in you. You are becoming a person full of love and full of joy and full of peace. The fruit of the Spirit is what is produced in you. And the gifts of the Spirit are what God does through you for others. The gifts are for others, and the fruit is what's being produced in you. So if you're walking according to where God wants you to walk, and you're having less love in your life, there's something wrong. And if you're getting less patient or less peace, that's because the fruit's not being produced. So first we look at people who are full of the fruit, that God has done something in them. Are you a person who's got love and joy and peace? Because that's the sign that you're attached into the vine. And if you're attached into the vine, you're producing fruit. And I made a comment here. I said, as fruit increases, the ability to feed does as well. The more fruit you have, the more God is going to trust you to feed other people. So when you've got love and joy and peace, God begins to give you more gifts because he can trust you to feed because you're producing the fruit. We're looking for people in the church who are being transformed. We're looking for men and women who are devoted to the vision and direction of the church. This is more than simply people who volunteer, but somebody who says, who we know will say yes when asked by leadership to help, to serve, or to lead. The original deacons were called to solve a discrimination problem, but at least two of them turned into evangelists. It's not always about the job, it's about the heart. That you are leading people in love and in seeing the lost get saved. And as we have said the last couple weeks, lost get saved, the saved transformed. That's what we want. That's what we desire. We're looking for people who are teachable. Somebody who we know we can disciple and correct. If you are not a correctable person, how can you be called to serve and submit to leadership in serving? If the moment there's a time for correction, you say, well, I don't agree. I don't agree to be corrected in that way. Because you know what? I used to think of myself, you know, I think we all do this. Everybody says, I'm teachable. I'm correctable. As long as you can prove to me in a 1,000-page essay exactly why I'm doing it wrong. And so really, you just always need to be the head. But actually, we're looking for people who are teachable. I had an incredible conversation the other day with somebody, and basically they said, they're talking about my dad, and they said, I didn't always agree with your dad, but I was willing to be led. It's not always about the agreement, it's about the willingness, the heart of somebody who's teachable. And I want to remind you that what we're looking for in leadership is not perfection. Perfection will only come when we come to see Jesus face to face one day. We are all broken and busted. But which is the direction of our lives? I was talking to one of the people we're calling into deaconship. I said, is the trajectory of your life up going this way? Because there's people who maybe have been in the church for 20 years, your trajectory's like this right now. And maybe you're even above somebody that we're calling into leadership. Who knows? But if your trajectory has stopped moving towards Jesus, you're in a bad direction. And so we are looking for people who are teachable. We're looking for people who are able to lead. A deacon is somebody who in love is devoted to the church, willing to be led and willing to lead others when called to it. I see in the world, if you love people deeply, you're not going to let them stay where they are. And so what we do is we see people who love so deeply that when people are walking in a direction they shouldn't be, we're already seeing them say, hey, you're hurting yourself by not being as close to God as you should be. They're already leading out of love, not out of authority, out of love. Why are you doing that? How? And they're walking people to freedom. You can see a leadership calling in their life. And I'll be honest, one of the other things that we're looking for in leadership is people who have one another's back, a person who defends. If we're going to call somebody into leadership, we got to know that when the battle comes and when the devil starts throwing arrows of accusations here, there, and everywhere, that the people have one another's back. We're looking for people who defend one another, people not willing to join in gossip, nitpicking, slander, accusations, because a deacon is a call to leadership. See, in the church, there are shepherds, and we're going to get to that in the shepherd series, who are called to give doctrine, discipline, direction, basically, if you simplify it, to teach and administer the affairs of the church. But in order to do that, we need people to be the hands and feet and to lead in that. And so I believe that we need to be looking at deacons this way. Deacons are a part of leadership. We see the deacons as part of our leadership. I know in the past I've talked about, hey, we got our leadership team, and I've worded it poorly, and I've been corrected in that. I used to just say the leadership team was the elders and their wives, but we're now going to call that the elder team, because deacons are part of our leadership team. We got our elder team, that's the elders and the wives, because each elder who is married is one with their wife. We have to be united. And the deacons, they're part of our team and our leadership. And they're the hands and the feet. We see deacons as part of leadership. They are the ones the elder team first trust with the vision. And they're the ones we trust to see the vision realized. They may not set direction, but without them, direction does not happen. They are people we trust to share and unpack vision with. They are trusted to walk with us through the struggles of the church. And they are people we trust to be the hands and the feet of the church, to bring the health that the church desires and that God desires for the church. And I believe that we should all strive to have every quality that we see in deacons. And with that to be said, I want to caution you. Do not be a person who is striving always for the title of something, because a true servant does not care. A true servant does not care. They just want church to go well. They just want family to be loved and cared for. They just want the hurting to be healed. So please caution yourself in this. But with that being said, I'm going to take a quick pivot here for a minute. Before I give the application that we're going to give to God for us to pray about in our own lives, there are people in the church that we, as we grow our leadership team, there are people in the church that we are seeing at that spot right now. That we've seen something in them, and in prayer we really believe that although many people might have those qualifications, that God is doing something specifically and putting a specific call of servant leadership in these people's lives. And so I want to mention them today, because in 2 weeks from now, as elders, we want to pray over them and actually anoint them. And what we mean by that is publicly recognize the authority that they should have as part of our leadership team. And so we're going to start with, I'm going to get people to stand up. I want Rick Perdue to stand up. Where's Rick? He's in the back there. Rick Perdue has been part of our church for a while, but we don't, out of full transparency, I shared this with him the other day. I have seen something incredible happen in his life, specifically over the last 2 years. He's been a believer for a while, but for the last 2 years, God has been doing some incredible transforming in his life. And I want to just share that, because the Bible talks about that deacons should be tested. And I don't just want to introduce who Rick is, but I want to show you that he has been through testing. He has not been perfect. He has made mistakes, and he has been correctable. And we've seen him be correctable. Rick is a guy who is currently leading a small group. There was a need in the church, and he said, I see a need. I will lead in it. And he's often in one of our offices, mine or Lauren's office, talking about how can I grow in this area. And when he makes mistakes and we say, hey, you could adjust this, he says, all right, let me do it. And when there's a need, he just says, let me fill it. And even when he doesn't have an abundance of resources, out of the resources that he's had, he has been tested and he has been shown as a person who just gives. The amount of Bibles that he has given, the amount of things he has given. And I'm not doing this to just brag on Rick, but I'm doing it because the Bible does say a person ought to be tested. And he's been tested. He's been corrected. He's been advised on different things. He's had to go and make things right. We talked about that a while back, and he has continually shown the heart of everything I just spoke about today. His life is in a trajectory that we love to see. And so in 2 weeks, we'd like to call him into deaconship. Connie Duick, where's Connie? Serving right now, right at the back. She's doing our screens up there. Connie Duick has been part of this church faithfully for as long as I can actually remember. Now, my ADHD means I don't remember a lot. But for as long as I can remember, she has been an important part of this church. She has led in missions. She has served served with our children's church, Safe Places. She's just in different youth programming and stuff. She has been faithful for so many years. There's no amount of testing that she has been through. She has been through it all, I think. She's been here when the church has gone through crisis. She's been pulled here and there by friends who chose to leave the church in times that were difficult. And she has been faithful. And she has an incredible heart. She has an incredible heart to see our church serve the world around us far more. And so we are so excited that God is calling her into this leadership role, along with her husband, Paul. Paul as well, in his own right, has served this church for, again, as long as I can remember. There's probably very few programs that he has not been actively involved with here. He often serves from the back. But in visiting with Paul, I think sometimes we forget. We see somebody doing this and we're like, oh, Paul's the sound video guy. No. I mean, he does that. Paul is a servant in this church, unbelievably. And in the times I've spent with Paul, even just recently with Paul and Connie, talking about their desire, I want to tell you, you know what I'm excited about? They were talking the other day about going up north in Manitoba to churches who don't have pastors because they're a bit more harder to get to and people don't want to work out there, or they've got pastors who are burning out, and sending teams from here to go do children's ministry and worship ministry and preach on a Sunday morning, packing up for the weekend, trucking up north, trucking here and there to serve the body of Christ around Manitoba in places that are struggling. Man, that is what we are looking for. And so we're so excited to see people who've adopted the vision of this church, who said, look, Rick, even if we don't always understand, we are willing to serve and we're willing to follow. They've both been through seasons of having to work with leadership. And so we are so excited to say that in 2 weeks we want to bring them on to our leadership team. And the reason we say 2 weeks is because we want to make sure that if we missed something, you guys have the opportunity to come and talk to us. Not to each other. We're not looking for nitpicky. Beep, 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 beep. You come talk to us. And you say, hey, I noticed something in this guy's life or this lady's life. Are you sure? Are you sure they're qualified? Because sometimes what happens is you have a brokenness with somebody and you don't realize that you're holding on to something that's been released a long time ago. Or you remember something that somebody did 2 years ago that they've repented of and they've moved forward in. And so you're judging them for past, and we're looking at where God is moving in their lives today. And so if there are things, just feel free to talk to us about it. Hey, what about this thing that this person did? Okay, we can talk about it. But I want you to also remember that your focus should be far more, do I see that in them right now? Is that what I have seen in them over the last 6 months? Over the last year? And one of the things that I really struggle with, both with the elders and with calling new people, is we tell you, if you see red flags, talk about it. Okay, talk to us about it. But you know what really sucks about that idea? We want you to affirm good things. It sucks when all we ever hear is, oh, one person with a red flag, one person with a red flag, and we don't spend the time as believers who love one another, who have another's back. Yeah, point out the red flags. But when you've seen God do good things in these people's lives, come and tell us that too. We want to hear a ton of affirmation too. We want to hear and be able to share with these guys that they have made a difference in your lives. We want to be a church that genuinely is family, not just a bunch of people looking for problems, but a bunch of people celebrating the great things that God has done. Because one day you too may be called to a role like this. And I sure hope that these guys get the same grace that you would deserve when called into that. And so I'm so excited for these guys coming on. If you have an issue, bring it to us. If you have an encouragement, bring it to us twice. We are so excited. But it kind of seems weird to end the service that way. Oh, here are the people we're bringing on. You all go home. Yeah, okay, I'm just going to focus on these three people who are coming on. No, no, no. I want to end the service going back to the message one last time. Every single one of you should be at a spot in your life. My goal, my dream, my heart is that you find God's purpose for your life. God has a purpose for your life, and you will find the purpose in community. And I want to be able to come to any one of you saying, hey, are you able to be used by God right now? Would you be willing to be used by God right now? And I want to ask you this morning, as we bring the worship team up, I'm just going to ask you a couple questions. And if there's any of these questions that you need to return to God and say, God, my heart needs to be adjusted. You guys come up already. Yeah, they're coming up. Okay. I want to remind us that we better make sure our hearts are right. Before we start looking at the speck in others, do I have a log in my own that needs to be dealt with? Do you love the church? I'm not talking, do you like all the things the church does? Would you genuinely make sacrifices to see the church be healthy? Because if not, do you have any comfort from what Christ did for you? Isn't that what he said? He said, if you have any, if there's any, then make joy complete. Are you devoted to the vision and direction of the church? Do you show up and participate? We just want to know that you're on board. Are you teachable? Are you growing in your ability to make a difference in other people's lives? Is there fruit that you have that God can use to feed others? Is there an overflow of love and joy and peace? Patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness and self-control that can help other people. If not, ask God, what is holding me back? Give things over to God. Are you growing in your ability? Do you shut down negative, judgmental talk? Do you have people's back? And if you don't have a desire to have these things, then check your heart. Because God says that Jesus came to serve, and we are to be like Jesus, to give all that we have for one another. Never forget that God has a purpose for your life. If you're here this morning, just quick, one last thing. If you're here this morning and you are not actually a follower of Christ, I'm going to tell you to you right now, God has pre-designed a purpose for your life. God has predetermined an incredible purpose, an incredible plan. He said, this is what I want for you. And guys, if you can find that family and that love, God is going to do something incredible in your life. Let's just pray. God, check my pride. God, help me to be a person who loves so much, who loves what you did on the cross, that I want to serve, not because I have to, but because I just want to model even a little bit of who you are. God, help me be a person who is compassionate, who is caring, who is kind, who serves. God, help me never to feel like I have something extra because I stand 4 feet higher than everybody else on a Sunday morning, but rather that I recognize that it was you who pulled me out of the mud and out of the quicksand that I so quickly step into day after day, that it is you who rescue me. And so God, help us to love people that deeply. And God, if there is anybody here right now who feels like they have not realized that they have a purpose and a plan, help them to find that purpose, find that plan. Help them to realize that without you, we have nothing. But with you and our brothers and sisters in Christ, we can live out that purpose and that plan. I just love you, Jesus, and all that you've done. You've pulled me from the quicksand so that I can help others. Help me make a difference. In your awesome name, we love you, Jesus. Amen. We're going to spend some time praying and singing, and I want to challenge you guys. We often have people up front. Anybody can come join us at the front. We love to do that as well. But I also want to challenge you that when you're singing these songs, two quick things. If you're singing a song and it doesn't hit home, then make that your prayer. If the song says, God, I'm so thankful for what you've done, and you're not thankful, then just change that and say, God, help me be thankful. God, help me to have joy. Help me. And also remember, church isn't just about you and Jesus. So in this time of prayer, go pray with people. Make it a point to say, I care enough that if God says, who can I pray with? Go pray with them. It's not just about praying with me. It's about praying with each other. I have nothing extra to offer other than what others can pray as well. So let's spend some time praying with one another as well.
God, before time, we are. To
Worship night this week. A bunch of you. That was fun.
So good.
That was so fun.
It was very fun.
Loved it. You guys were into it. We're gonna do a favorite from that one. So let's all come up to the front and just have a party.
African plane. It's the sun.
winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing.
God is good. Hey, just as we go, a couple things I just realized I want to pray for quickly. Ed Trader's aunt passed away, and he's doing a funeral today. Orlando Weeb had had emergency appendectomy. There we go. And so we got to pray for them. As well. There's just a bunch of other people are going through stuff. So we're just going to close with that. God, you are so awesome. We love you so much. We know you care for your family. God, I want to pray for Ed, that he just have a ton of peace today as he does this funeral. I want to pray for Orlando as he's had this operation happen. I want to just pray for a quick recovery and a ton of peace as well. God, I want to pray for those who are sick and who are hurting, that we be a church who looks out for one another through it all. We love you, Jesus. Amen. 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 Don't forget to help with the chairs and sign up for the 24 hours of prayer, okay? Blessings, guys. Thank you very much.